السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. Okay, we're continuing with Zad al-Mustaqnia fi ikhtisar al-Muqni', and by Allah's grace and permission, we've reached the chapter where he says, the author al-Hajjawi, Babu Zakat al-Urud, the chapter pertaining to trade goods. حدث في الخامس مما تجب في زكاة. So this is the fifth category of whereupon zakah is obligatory. عروض التجارة. والعروض, the word عروض, جمع عرض, is the plural of عرض. عرض بإسكان الراء, with the سكون on the راء, not a ضمة on the راء, not a فتحة on the راء, a سكون. والمراد بها ما أعد للبيع والشراء لأجل الربح. And the intent with this word عروض, trade goods, is that which has been prepared for purchasing and selling, okay, with the intention to make a profit. لأجل ربح. سميت بذلك لأنها تعرض لتباع وتشتري. It's been given the name عروض from the meaning of عرض, because its intent is that it's put forward and it's exposed, it's put out in front of people to be sold and to be purchased. What's the evidence for عروض التجارة? A question to yourselves. What's the evidence for giving money, zakah, for paying zakah on trade goods? And I mentioned this in passing in the previous lecture, I believe. So we have the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا كَسَبَتُمْ وَمِمَّا أَخْرَجْنَا لَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. Oh, you who believe, spend, give charity, give zakah from the good of that which you have earned and from that which we have brought forth for you from the earth. هذه الآية تدل على وجوب زكاة عروض التجارة. So the ulama, they said that this ayah, this verse, it gives evidence to the obligatory, to the obligation of zakat عروض التجارة. كما نقل هذا عن الحسن والمجاهد, as the great mufassirins like Mujahid and al-Hasan, they said. وبوب إمام البخاري على هذه الآية باب صدقة الكسب والتجارة. And Imam Bukhari, رحمه الله تعالى, in his famous book Sahih of Hadith, which is not only a book of Hadith, it's also a book of fiqh, because the titles that he chose for his chapter headings, okay, were fiqh titles. So when he gave the title heading for his chapter where he said Babu Sadaqat al-Kasb wa-Tijara, the chapter of Zakat or Sadaqah on that which is earned and that which is traded, he put forth this ayah as a chapter heading, which shows that he intended to extract from this ayah what we've just mentioned, that it's a proof for the fact that Urud al-Tijara, Zakat Urud al-Tijara is wajib. So the author, he says in his first statement, إِذَا مَلَكَهَا بِفَعْلِهِ بِنِيَةِ التِّجَارَةِ. If the person owns these goods with the intention of trading, and also وَبَلَغَتْ قِيمَتُهَا نِصَابٍ, and also if the value of these products that he has, that he intends to sell, they reach the level of نصاب. يَشْتَرِطُ لِوَجُوبِ زَكَاةِ فِي أُرُودِ التِّجَارَةِ شُرُوطٍ. So Sheikh Mansour, he explains to us that there's conditions which are to be observed when considering the payment of zakah or urud tijara. The first of them, أن يملكها بفعله, that the person should have possession of these goods through an action of his own. That through an action, he should have possession of these goods. كأن يشتريها, like he has purchased them. So purchasing the goods is an action. أو تهدى إليه ويقبلها. Or it's given to him as a gift and he accepts this gift. So in the madhab, by virtue of him accepting a gift and he intends that this gift is going to be used as a trade good, then that is enough to fit under the category of this condition. ونحو ذلك. فتكون قد دخلت في ملكه. So with this, with trading, as an example, if he has the action of trading, going out and making trade, then of course these trade goods fit under this condition of being from عروض التجارة. And if he accepts, as we said, a hibba, okay, if he accepts a gift, then the acceptance of the gift falls under the condition which the author mentioned, which was إِذَا مَلَكَهَا بِفِعْلِهِ بِنْدِيَةِ التِّجَارَةِ. If he obtains these goods with his action, with the intention of selling. Also from the condition mentioned, أَنْ يَنْوِي إِنْدَ تَمَلُّكِهَا التِّجَارَ بِهَا, that from the time that he has possession of these goods, he has to have the intention that he's going to trade with these goods. وَالنِّيَةُ التِّجَارَةِ هِيَ التَّحَرِّي الْبَيْءِ, and the niyyah of tijara, the intention of trading, is that you actually go out and you look to trade with these goods. Okay, there has to be actual action taking place, not just an intention. لِقَصْدِ الْرِبْحِ وَالْكَسْبِ, and this intention of trading the goods is of course for earning money and for earning profit. لَا مُجَرَّدَ الْقَصْدِ الْبَيْءِ, not simply just a trade. If it's simply just a trade, like given the example by Sheikh Mansour, لِتَخَلَّسْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ لِعَدْمِ رَغْبَةٍ فِيهَا, like a person has land and he just simply wants to get rid of the land because he doesn't want it anymore. So he's not really looking to do it as a trade in the sense of earning profit. So this doesn't fall under the discussion of what we are saying. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْمُرَادَ أَن تَكُونَ نِيَّةُ التِّجَارَ بِهَا مُقَارَنَةً لِتَمَلُّكِهَا, and be aware that the niyyah of tijara, the intention of tijara, has to be there at the time when the person has got hold of this product. Once the person is in possession of the product, then at the same time, he has to have the intention to trade in this product for it to be urud tijara. فَيَنْوِي أَنَّهَا لِتِجَارَ مِنْ أَوَّلِ مَا مَلَكَهَا وَسَيَأْتِ زِيَادَةُ بَيَانٍ لِهَذَا. So we'll give more information on this, the Sheikh Mansour, he said, as we go on. A point to mention, sorry, I'm struggling a bit today because I have a very bad backache. Alhamdulillah, make dua for me inshallah later. A point to mentioned by Sheikh Abdeslam Shuayr, is that he said that Imam al-Mirdawi in Al-Insaf, he said, أَنَّ تَرَدُّدْ فِي النِّيَّةَ كَمَنْ لَا نِيَّ لَهُ, that the one who has taraddud in his niyyah, like he's going back and forth in his attention, shall I sell this product, I'm going to sell it, then he changes his mind, then I'm going to sell it again, he changes his mind. He said, أَتَرَدُّدْ فِي النِّيَّةَ كَمَنْ لَا نِيَّ لَهُ, so the one who goes back and forth with his intention, it's as though he has no intention, okay? So the intention has to be firm. Also from the conditions of zakah on the urud tijara, أَنْ تَبْلُغُ نِصَابٍ مِنْ أَحْدِ النَّقْدَيْنِ, that this product that you are trading in, the value of these products, they reach the nisab of either the gold or the silver. الذهب أو الفضة بالأقل منهما. Okay, and it reaches the nisab of gold or silver, the least of the two. We'll explain this a bit further with examples. So whichever is the least in nisab from gold or silver at the time of paying your zakah on the urud tijara, that is the one that you will look to, whether the nisab of the gold or the nisab of the silver. فَإِذَا كَانَ عِنْدَهُ أُرُودِ التِّجَارَةِ لَكِنَّهَا دُونَ نِصَابٍ فَلَا زَكَاةَ فِيهَا. So of course, if the person has trade goods, but they don't reach the value of the nisab, then there's no zakah in that. The author, may Allah have mercy upon him, he says, زَكَّى قِيمَتَهَا. So with these conditions that we've just mentioned, after it, the author is saying that if those conditions are present, then the person, he gives أُرُودِ التِّجَارَةِ the zakah on its value. زَكَّى قِيمَتَهَا. So what do we understand, question to yourselves, what does this tell us about how we pay the zakah of the urud al-tijara, zakah qimatuha? What does this tell us about how to pay zakah for the trade goods? It tells us something very important. Barakallahu feek. So this is to do with it, and this is what the author will mention in a few phrases down the road. But at this point, what the ulama, they mentioned, such as Sheikh Ahmed Amir Bahjat in his explanation, zakka qimataha, it means, for example, if a person has 40 acres of land, as an example, a person has 40 acres of land, and now at the time of giving zakah, he says, okay, I'm going to give 1/40th of my land in zakah. They said, this is not going to be acceptable, because qimataha is mentioned, that the value, the trade goods, the zakah is given from the value of the trade goods, not from the goods themselves. So the zakah in the madhab is not given from the goods themselves. You cannot give the clothes that you are selling as zakah. You cannot give the land that you are selling as zakah. It has to be from the value of the currency, value of gold and silver, of the trade goods, right? So you cannot give a 40th of the land. Rather, you have to give a 40th of the monetary value of the land. This is the opinion in the madhab. Shaykh Sami ibn Abdurrahman, in his explanation, he says that Shaykh Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that if there is a maslaha, if there is an apparent benefit for the poor in receiving the actual trade goods instead of the monetary value, okay, then in this situation the goods themselves can be given as zakah. But of course, as we mentioned, the madhab is that it has to be from the value of the trade goods. طيب, the author, he said, فَإِن مَلَكَهَا بِإِرْثٍ, if the person came across these goods came into his possession by the form of irth. Irth is, for example, inheritance. So if they came into his possession by the form of inheritance, there will be no zakah here upon the goods. Why? Question to yourselves, why? Based upon what we just discussed and the previous conditions. So a person, he inherits a plot of land and he wants to trade this plot of land. He wants to use this plot of land for trading, or inherits five cars and he wants to use these five cars for trading. So our author is saying that there will be no zakah on these products because he inherited it. Why is this the case from looking at the conditions that we just took? طيب, they say لأن الإرث ملك جبري. They say because إرث is ملك جبري. إرث is something which is forced upon him, in the sense that when the distribution of the inheritance is given and Yusuf is given the five cars, Yusuf says, I don't want to have the five cars, I don't want to take them. But Islam tells him, no, you have to take them due to the inheritance. What you do with it after that, whoever you give it to, that's your business. But you have to take it. So here, he didn't want to have the product, but rather it was forced upon him. So earth inheritance is considered mulk jabri. فَلَا تَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ زَكَاة. So zakah on earth, on inheritance, is not obligatory, even though the person is going to intend trade goods. لأنه ملكها بغير اختياره, because it came into his possession without his choice. Without his choice. So when would the zakah be obligatory upon him? إذا باعها وقبض ثمنها من النقود يبدأ حساب الحول لهذه النقود. So at the time, when would the zakah become obligatory upon this person, in the example that I've given of Yusuf and the five cars that he's inherited, they would come, the zakah would be obligatory upon him, not as at the time that he has sold them. So once he sold them and he's received money, then from the time that he's received the money for these goods, that's when the hawl, the year, starts to be counted for zakah on these goods in this situation. So the first exemption from trade goods that the author mentioned, he mentioned that if a person inherits goods, okay, then there's no zakah on those goods, even if they're with him for 10 years. The only time the zakah on those goods that are received from inheritance is obligatory is once the person sells and receives money for that, then the counting of the year begins, then the counting of the hawl begins. أو بفعله بغير نية التجارة. This is another reason where there won't be zakat on the tijara. If a person went out and made the action to purchase and to trade goods, so he got hold of goods with his own action, but he didn't have the intention to trade. At the time of purchasing five cars, he didn't have the intention to trade. Rather, he was going to give them as gifts to people, to his family, right? But then later on, this person, Yusuf, who had five cars, for example, he decides that now I want to sell them and use them as trade goods. The author, he says, ثُمَّ نَوَاهَا لَمْ تَصِرْ لَهَا. So if this person, he purchases goods, but he didn't have the intention of selling them at that time of purchasing, and later on, he changes his mind to make it into trade goods, then these don't become trade goods, okay? So an example that Sheikh Amir Bahjat gives, he said, if a person buys land, and when asked, why did you buy the land? He said, to build a house upon this land, right? And to ensure that my family has a place to live. Is there going to be zakah on the land? No, there's not going to be any zakah on the land because he didn't purchase it with the intention for trading. Later he changes his mind and he wants to now use the land for trading, for buying and selling, right? At this point also, there's no zakah on the land. The zakah becomes on the land once it's sold and he receives money. Once it's sold and he receives money, then the hawl starts and that's when he has to pay the zakah. And then the Sheikh also mentioned, Sheikh Amal Bahjat, he mentioned a nice point. وَلَوْ أَخْرَجَ الْإِنسَانَ زَكَاتَ خُرُوجًا مِنَ الْخِلَافِ مِنْ مِثْلِ حَدِيثِ صُوَرِ فَإِنَّهُ حَسَنٌ. He said, however, if a person does pay zakat in the situations like we've mentioned, then it's a good thing in order to come out of the differences of opinions that exist with the ulama. So you see that ulama, they're always looking for ways to come out of the differences of opinions. Though he's saying it's not obligatory upon you, because the madhab is not saying it's obligatory, but he's saying that if you do it to avoid the differences of opinions which are found amongst the scholars, then this is something which is good. The author, he says, وَتُقَوَّمُ إِنْدَ الْحَوْلِ بِالْأَحَدِّ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ مِنْ عَيْنٍ أَوْ وَرَقٍ. The author, he says, with regards to paying the zakat on the urud al-tijara, at the time of the hawl, at the time when you have your date to pay the zakat, then you would make the value of the trade goods, okay, and you would بِالْأَحَدِّ لِلْفُقَرَاء. بِالْأَحَدِّ لِلْفُقَرَاء means that you will give the value of the trade goods to which is most appropriate and beneficial to the poor. Min ayn. Ayn here means dhahab, means gold. Aw waraqin, and waraq means silver. So when you value your trade goods, you're going to look at the nisab of gold and silver, but you're going to see which one is more beneficial for the poor person. This will come clear with an example now in a few minutes. So first thing to mention here, he says, وَتُقَوَّمُ إِنْدَ الْحَوْلِ. So the trade goods that are given the value at the time when there is a hawl, okay, when at the time of the hawl. And the hawl doesn't necessarily start at the time of the purchase. So say for example, as a trader, I normally give my goods, I normally give my zakat on my goods and my wealth and other assets in January. But in March, I purchase a range of products which reach the nisab. So these range of products, though they have been purchased in March, the zakat is going to be given for them with the rest of my wealth in next January, not in next March. So the consideration of the hawl is at the time when I normally give my zakat, not at the time of purchase, right? So this is the first thing that the ulama, they mentioned. The second thing to bear in mind is that they said al-hadh huwa al-qal. So the most appropriate for the fuqara and the most beneficial for the fuqara in terms of valuing your trade goods and giving the zakah is to look to the nisab of gold or silver and to see which one is more beneficial. So first question to yourselves, what is the nisab of gold and silver? Please somebody answer quickly. What is the nisab of gold and silver? طيب, the nisab of gold is 85 grams and the nisab of silver is 595 grams. So we find that today, for example, in Qatar or in this part of the Middle East, you will find that a gram of gold is 208 riyals, and you'll find that a gram of silver is 2.65 riyals only. So now, which one is going to be more beneficial for the fuqara, for the poor, in terms of us working out which nisab to use when we value our trade goods? When we work out the value of the trade goods, should I work it out according to gold, okay, or should I work it out according to silver? Which one is going to be more beneficial for the fuqara? Silver, barakallah fiqh, silver, of course, because it means that, say for example, your trade goods are worth only let's say 1500 riyals. If your trade goods are only worth 1500 riyals or 2000 riyals, then it will fit into the nisab of silver, meaning that you still go ahead and you will give the zakah because it fits into the nisab of the silver. However, if you value your trade goods according to the gold is around, I think, 17,000 riyals, works out the 85 grams. 17,000 riyals or so, if I'm not mistaken. So the person who only has like 2,000 riyals worth of trade goods, it means that he's not going to pay the zakah if he works it out or if he equates it to the nisab of the gold. So the author is telling us that you equate your you use the nisab which is more beneficial for the fuqara, and that of course is the lower one. In our time today, silver is the lower of the two nisabs. Previously, in the time of the Prophet ﷺ and years after that, the nisab of gold and silver were very similar. But in today's time, they are much different. the one which is more beneficial for the fuqara is the lower of the two, and that is silver. The author, he says, وَلَا يُؤْتَبَرُ مَا اسْتُرِيَتْ بِهِ. The author, he says, what the brother mentioned previously in his answer to another question is that you don't consider the price, or you don't consider that which the product was bought at. Okay? You don't consider the price of the product when it was purchased. Rather, you consider the price of the products, the value of the products, the market value of the products at the time when you are to pay your zakah. So once the hawl has been complete on your wealth, and now you have to pay zakah in January or Ramadan any month, then at that time you look at the market value of your goods and you pay the zakah based upon the market value of the goods now when you are paying the zakah, not the value of the goods at the time of purchase. Sheikh Sami al-Suqayr, hafidhahullah ta'ala, in his explanation of Rawd al-Murbi', he mentioned that there's a great wisdom here. He said, look, if a person bought a trade product at 10 riyals, right, and now at the time of paying the zakah, it's 1,000 riyals, it's worth 1,000 riyals. So if the rule was that you have to go back and you have to value your products at the time of when you purchase them, he said they're only going to be worth 10 riyals and that's not going to benefit the fuqara. But by the fact that you're paying them at the value of what they're worth now, which is 1,000 riyals, it's going to be beneficial for the fuqara, right? And also he said another example from the perspective of the trader. He said if the trader bought them at 1,000 riyals, right, bought the product at 1,000 riyals, but now they're worth only 10 riyals, okay, I know it's an extreme example, but now they're worth only 10 riyals, so if it was said to him, you have to pay your zakah at the value of when you purchased it, which was 1,000, but now it's only worth 10, this is going to be detrimental and harmful for the trader. So there's wisdom in this fiqh that the ulama have mentioned, that وَلَا يُعْتَبَرُ مَا اشْتُرِيَتْ بِهِ, that the consideration for the valuing of the goods is not at the time of purchase, it's at the time when zakah is obligatory upon the goods at the market value then. The author, he says, وَنْ اِشْتَرَى عَرْضًا بِنِصَابٍ مِنْ أَثْمَانٍ أَوْ أَرُودْ بَنَى عَلَى حَوْلِهِ. The author, he says, that if the person changes his trade goods, for example, he swaps his trade goods for cash, okay, or he swaps one set of trade goods for another set of trade goods, then the hawl, the year, is not broken. It doesn't have to be started again due to this exchange. So Sheikh Amir Bahjat, he explains, he said that إِذَا تَبَدَلَتْ أُرُو التِّجَارَ بِنِصَابٍ مِنَ الْأَثْمَانِ مِنْ ذَهَبٍ وَالْفِضَّةِ فَالْحَوْلُ مُسْتَمِرٌ مَا تَصَفَّرْ الْأَعْدَادِ. Okay, he said, for example, a person, he has trade goods and now he exchanges them through selling for their value in wealth, right? So now he owns the wealth, the hawl, okay, due to this exchange is not broken, the year is not broken. And likewise also, if a person says, for example, going back to this first point, when اشترى عرضا بنصاب من أثمان, so if the person exchanges his trade goods for wealth, then the hawl, the year, is not broken, it continues, right? And why is there a continuation in the hawl? Because the intent of the urud al-tijara, the intent of the trade goods, is not the trade goods itself, but it's rather the value that they earn or the value that they hold. So, as the ulama, they say, فَكَأَنَّهُ اِشْتَرَى شَيْئًا بِجِنْسِهِ. So it's as though he bought something from its same category, because wealth and wealth, right? Wealth in the form of cash and wealth in the form of trade goods. So he exchanged the trade goods for wealth in the form of cash. It's though they're the same thing, because the trade goods, they are wealth, but in the form of trade goods. But the second part of what the author said, أَوْعَرُودْ بَنَ عَلَى هَوْلِهِ. And also if he exchanged trade goods for another set of trade goods, then again the hawl is not broken. So as Sheikh Amir, he mentioned, إِذَا تَبَدَّلَتْ الْعُرُودْ بِالْعُرُودْ عُرُودْ تِجَارَ بِعُرُودْ تِجَارَ, then the hawl, it continues. For example, somebody, he's a car salesman, but after a year or 2 years, he gets bored of selling cars and he says, now I want to move into selling motorbikes or boats. So in this situation, he sells his trade stock of cars and he purchases with that value, or he exchanges those cars for motorbikes. Now here the hawl has not broken. The hawl has continued as though he had his original product. The author, he says, وَإِنْ اِشْتَرَاهُ بِسَائِمَةٍ لَمْ يَبْنِي. However, if he purchases with his trade goods, سَائِمَة. And as if you remember, سَائِمَة are those animals which are kept like cows, sheep, and they graze freely on the earth in the pastures. Then if he does this, if he exchanges his trade goods for cattle, then in this situation, the hawl will be broken. Surat al-Mas'ala. When the ulama, they say Surat al-Mas'ala, they say the conceptualization of the issue. So they try to give an example to help us conceptualize the issue. So Sheikh Mansur al-Saqa'ub, he gives Surat al-Mas'ala. He said, Zayd indahu mi'a min al-ghanam. Zayd has 100 sheep. Wa qabla al-hawl ba'aha. And before the hawl, before the year finishes, he sells the sheep. Wa ishtara bi thamaniha urudi tijara. And then he purchases with the wealth products for trade, urud al-tijara. فَإِنَّهُ يَسْتَعْنِفْ حَوْلًا جَدِيدًا. So in this situation, there will be a new hawl. The hawl won't continue because the products are completely different, as he mentions. The illah. He says the reason, the illah, اِخْتِلَافُ الْمَالَيْنِ فِي الْأَنْصِبَةِ وَالْمَقَاصِدِ. He said because the malain, the two types of wealth, the sa'ima, the cattle, and now what he's purchased are complete opposites, are completely different with regards to their ansiba, with regards to their nisabs, and with regards to their maqasid, and with regards to their objectives. فَالنِسَابُ مُخْتَلِفْ وَالْمَقْصَدُ مُخْتَلِفْ فَفِي الْأَوَّلِ الْقَصْدُ أَدَرُ وَالْإِسْتِعْمَالُ وَفِي الثَّانِي التِّجَارَةُ. So with regards to a person having cattle, his objective is that he wants to make them breed, and he wants to produce milk and stuff like that. But with regards to trade, it's a complete different objective altogether. وَكَذَا عَكْسُ الْمَسْأَلَةِ. And also the opposite. لَوْ كَانَ عِنْدَهُ أُرُودَ التِّجَارَةِ. If a person has trade goods, أُرُودَ التِّجَارَةِ. ثُمَّ أَثْنَاء الْحَوْلِ بَاعَهَا وَاشْتَرَ بِهِ أَغْنَامًا. And then in half of the year, he sells these trade products and he buys sheep. لَا بِنِيَةِ التِّجَارَةِ. And the sheep are not bought in order to trade. Rather, he just wants to have a farm where he's going to have 50 sheep. And he wants to enjoy farming the sheep and taking the milk from them and letting them grow and using them for other reasons. فَإِنَّ الْحَوْلِ الْأَغْنَامِ يَبْدَى مِنْ حِينَ اشْتَرَاهَا. So this hawl doesn't continue from the time of his trade goods. Rather, from the time he purchased these sheep, that is when his hawl will start. Why? Because they were completely different with regards to the nisab, and they're completely different with regards to the objective of having them. So the trade goods and the sa'ima are completely different. Not like the previous example we gave of somebody exchanges goods for goods, or exchanges goods for cash. Because goods for cash, they have the same objective and they have the same nisab. There's a mas'ala mentioned here. مَا الْحُكَمْ إِذَا كَانَ إِنْدَ الْإِسَانِ مَاشِيَ سَائِمًا وَقَدْ نَوَهَا لِلْتِجَارَةِ فَهَلْ تُزَكَّى زَكَاتُ سَائِمًا. So if a person, he has mashia, he has cattle, sheep, etc., and they are sa'ima, and he intends with these flocks or groups of cattle, etc., that he wants to use them for trade. He wants to use them from trade. طيب. Is the zakah given as urud al-tijara, or is it given as sa'ima? Okay, is it given as what we took in the previous lessons, that when you have five camels, it's one sheep, etc., like this? Or is it given at the value of gold and silver, 2.5% of what is of what the value of your animals are? طيب, the Hanbali madhab holds أنها تزكى زكاة urud. That in this situation, because the person intended it for urud al-tijara, even though they are sa'ima, they are going to be for urud al-tijara. So the zakat is given as 2.5% of the value of the livestock that the person has, according to the more beneficial nisab for the fuqara, which we said is in more than often is going to be silver. Also, something to add with regards to the zakat on trade goods is that a person who has a shop, for example, he's selling clothes, so the shelves that he uses for selling the clothes, the boards that he has purchased for advertising the clothes, the cars that he uses for delivering clothes and going to purchase clothes, all of these assets, okay, which are not in of themselves intended to be sold, they are not to be included in the value of urud at-tijara, in the trade goods. And inshallah, we'll stop here. And as I said, excuse me for the brevity of the lesson. If you have any quick questions pertaining to the topic or clarifications, feel free. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward us all for this little effort that we made. Ameen. Wa jazakumullah khair.